Did you ever wonder how giant container cranes retire? We are very used to seeing containers all around us. They travel on trucks, rail, ships, used as a storage, and even houses are built out of them. However, the story is a bit different with ship-to-shore cranes that move containers around ships. Many people are very surprised to see those cranes for the first time due to their pure size. Today, I'm going to show you how those giants retire. Ship-to-shore cranes are big. Modern cranes can easily be 300 feet tall, with an overall weight of somewhere around 1500 to 2000 tons. The price tag for modern cranes is around $15 million, and there are only few factories in the world that can design and build them. The typical life cycle of the crane is around 50 years. Some cranes do not make it that long. Corrosive environment and non-stop usage take its toll, and sooner or later it will be the time for crane to retire. There are two basic ways to demolish the crane: controlled freefall or dismantling. The controlled freefall is used if port can free enough space behind the crane, where the entire structure can safely land. Loose dirt is placed on a pavement behind the crane, then wooden mats are placed on the top of the dirt. Legs of the cranes are properly cut and the crane is pushed to fall on the ground. Wooden mats absorb energy of the impact and transfer it to loose soil, which acts like a pillow, dissipating energy of the impact. This is how freefall looks with a yard crane. But this is not what we will be doing today. Today we will dismantle two old cranes. The gray one is 235 feet tall to the tip of the boom. It was built in 1980. And the blue one is 276 feet tall to the tip of the boom. It was built in 1989. Dismantling is used a lot more often, especially in busy ports, because it takes a lot less space. Process of dismantling is very simple. Pieces of the crane are cut off and lowered to the ground. The process requires two construction cranes. One is used as a lift. It lifts a small bucket with workers that will cut pieces of the crane with cutting torch. The other crane is the one that does the heavy lift. It will hold a piece that is being cut and then lower it to the ground. Prior to demolition, all fluids from the container cranes are drained, which are mainly gear and hydraulic oils that move different parts of the crane. Then the crane is also disconnected from the power. Ship-to-shore cranes typically run on 12,000 volts, so you don't want to mess around with the energized crane. Container cranes have electric brakes. Since crane has no power, it is not wise to rely on its electric brakes. So to make sure it will not run away, the crane is secured via tie downs. Essentially, tie down is a big tie rod that gets connected to the crane and the other side is secured to the wharf structure. Under normal circumstances, tie down points are used to secure cranes during windy situations, such as hurricanes and storms, to provide crane stability. Otherwise, crane may tip over or wind can push crane around and it may crash into another crane. Finally, we are ready to start cutting pieces. There are not many choices of how to dismantle a container crane. Boom is taken down first. Next, the machine room is removed. Then the back of the trolley girder is cut to balance distribution of the weight. Next, the tip of the crane is cut, which is called an apex. And then the remaining frame is slowly cut down. You may assume that the hardest part is to make the very first cut at the tip of the boom, since it is high and far to reach point, but that is not the case. Crane sits on the rails. The wheel assembly that sits over the rail is called buggy. Above buggies, we have a massive steel beam that is called seal beam. Two seal beams are connected by two cross members that are called portal beams. The hardest part is cutting portal beams. When the second portal beam is cut, legs have no more stability. and they must be held artificially with some kind of bracing system, otherwise they will fall. The landside steel beam is not a problem. In fact, it usually is pushed down, under control of course. Waterside steel beam is a problem. If it is not held properly, it may fall into the water, and that would be a very big problem. Fishing such a large piece that weighs around 100 tons out of 60 feet deep water can be a bit challenging. Prior to the work commencement, structural engineers review original design drawings and then develop a detailed lift plan, where each peak is accounted for to ensure overall safety of the project. Each peak requires precise calculations by the engineers to determine where the center of gravity of each piece is. That dictates where lifting points of the piece will be. There are a lot of risks in dismantling procedures, and many things can go south very quickly, so it is important to prepare a detailed lift plan. Besides main lift issues, the field crew also needs to account for smaller auxiliary parts, such as handrails, steps, conduits, and others that may accidentally fall, since the overall structural integrity of the crane is broken. These items are not accounted by the engineers and must be taken care of by the experienced field crew. As large pieces are lowered to the ground, they are cut into smaller pieces that can be transported to the scrapyard. Some pieces are cut with torch, some are cut by the shear excavator, that makes this process much faster. Surface of the wharf is usually durable and does not require too much care. However, for additional protection, it may be covered by wooden mats. Now you know how cranes retire. If you like construction and engineering how-to videos, don't forget to hit like and subscribe buttons.